buy, and you can drive over there and you can sit where you like. Yeah.
What do you think?
Yeah, no, I think that would be great. One more minute. Yeah, so that's kind of where I was.
Okay.
All right, we'll start in a minute.
I'm going to be right back.
Where are you going?
Papa wants the jammer that I bought him.
Are you allowed to bring it in?
What's that?
Can you bring it in for me?
Yeah. Like, are you allowed to? Absolutely. Yeah. Is it shellfish or pork? No, it's not. So you can bring it in.
I mean, you guys are. We're going to start in the
Just a couple minutes.
If this is better, hopefully that's good for everyone. I'm just gonna scooch this over. Thank you so much for being here. I am really pleased to present this work at the Eastside Jewish Commons in Portland, and to have you guys come here tonight to explore
the journey of making these two narrative paintings that I did make in my time as a fellow with the Art Lab program through CoLab. We had a period of 7 months to explore Jewish theme, and it turned out that my work actually has quite a bit to do with the theme that we undertook, which is the theme of the year of Shemitah. It's a every 7 year cycle where the land is set to rest, and it's part of Jewish law. And I wasn't super familiar with that part of Jewish law when we started our study. So I am a painter, and I am a queer artist, and I am Jewish, and those are parts of my identity that I tend to put into my work. And these two paintings have a lot to do with both of those topics, but also considering land, which is the big part of Shemitah, is considering that land is holy. And we have a lot, as Jewish people, a lot of baggage that goes with land, and a lot of baggage that goes with holy land also. So that's kind of the theme of this talk, is what does land mean to us as Jewish people, or just as people who have been forcibly moved from land or asked to relocate across different lands. I did want to just offer a content advisory. There are some sensitive subjects in what I will share with you about the making of these paintings. That includes diasporic histories, which I've just kind of gone over already. We're all familiar with that. There's been quite a lot of movement for Jewish people across the earth, right? Oops. I won't trip over this microphone. But part of these paintings is exploring what those lands are and where people have come from who do have Jewish identity. We also have some nudity. So that's always sensitive for different reasons. But one of these paintings does feature a nude figure. It is from the back. But there's also some nudity in some of the reference photos that I will show. They are not of me, so don't worry. But they are other artists who use nudity in their works, especially queer artists who discuss the body and the meaning of queer bodies. We also have some mentions of racism, colonialism, anti-Semitism, all of the isms, and violence towards Jewish and queer people, because those are some of the parallels that I'm trying to speak about in this work. Drawing parallels between queer experience with Jewish experience. And also I wanted to just acknowledge and say thanks also to Josh Rose and Shoshana Guggenheim-Kiedem, who are the co-founders of the Art Lab program, which Eric already mentioned, for giving us the space and the time to do this kind of work where we get to explore our identities through making either visual artworks or writing, performance, and that was with the Art Lab Fellowship. I also wanted to thank the Eastside Jewish Commons because this is amazing. Yes, and so thank you so much for affording the space and allowing us time to show you our work. And I've already mentioned Shemitah. So was anyone here familiar with the concept of the Shemitah law already? Okay. Well, I gave you the basics, and there's also another part of just in the scripture that talks about Shemitah that states that during the year of Shemitah, all ownership of the land is reevaluated. And that it's also part of reality, according to Jewish law, that the land is divine and is not owned by anyone except for divinely. That can be a controversial take, but it's also part of what I've hoped to weave into these paintings with the queer read of that if we are from the land, if everybody's body comes from the things that we eat that come from the land, then we are also divine. And that in that sense, there's no room for oppressing those who are divine. So that's one of these connections within this work. I'm going to attempt to share some pictures on this little screen here, so one moment. Just to show you some of the reference materials that will help these paintings make more sense and kind of tell the story of the narrative in the paintings. As a Jewish person, I do find it is my responsibility to remember. That's one of those things that we get taught, that it is part of our responsibility as a group to keep memories alive and to remember history. And when I started looking at what that meant to me individually, I noticed some parallels with other people in that when you look back at your family heritage and where your members of your family have come from, that's a big frame of reference for Jewish people, is to look back where your family came from. Since my family is Ashkenazi, we did come from areas that are detailed on this map over here on the painting to my right. Those were areas of what were once parts of empires of Belarusian empires, the Polish governments, and then also parts of Russia. The reason it's so difficult to say where those parts are necessarily identified with is because the borders and the boundaries around these areas shifted so frequently with ownership being tossed back and forth between different empires. This is part of the thing that actually led to establishment of the Pale of Settlement. And I'm just curious, does anyone here recognize that terminology, Pale of Settlement? So looking back into Jewish history, I was concerned that we primarily look at, here in the United States at least, what is concerned with World War II. And we do learn in general education about World War I, which preceded World War II, right? But then the period before World War I, we don't really learn that much about. And the fact is that the Pale of Settlement was a huge part of what determined what happened with Jewish people in Europe. Prior to World War I, there were about 200 years of an imposed settlement in which Jewish people from Russian Empire areas were not allowed to live outside of the Pale of Settlement. The map that I've used as the reference point for this painting comes from an historian who's widely known as one of the craziest, nerdiest people to ever write about Jewish history, Martin Gilbert. He's actually Sir Martin Gilbert. He's in England. Well, he was. He has passed away. He was the premier Jewish historian to come out of England. He was also the premier biographer of Sir Winston Churchill, but that's not related to this talk. So I did initially look at this book as part of my father's book collection, and it's very depressing. There's a lot of map activity that just shows all of the movement of Jewish people across the past 2,000 years. But for the part of time, the part of history that I was interested in exploring, I did work from a map compiled by Martin Gilbert that details the Pale of Settlement. And it is kind of tiny here, so you might not be able to see this very well. But you can see in the painting over there a lot of where I drew materials from. This area that's outlined with the dark border is what was referred to as the Pale of Settlement. And if you look through some of the names that are listed here, I'm certain that you will recognize some of them, including Kyiv, which we've all heard a lot about recently, Warsaw, And all of these areas of Vilna that are very important in Jewish history, especially as cultural centers. Some of these cities actually did not allow Jewish people to live in them during the Pale of Settlement. This is part of our history, especially Eastern European Jewish people. It's part that we don't really hear very much about, but this is what preceded the Holocaust. This is what happened before, and these are reasons that people came to the United States in waves, because they were actually reacting to the loss and lack of property rights, the inability to have to work in certain trades, the prohibition of working in agriculture. All of these things were parts of having the Pale of Settlement established, and that was during the Tsarist reign in Russia. So for me, looking at this, it just really helped me as an artist and as a person looking into my identity to understand this is part of where my family comes from. And then I did actually end up looking even more deeply to see where my actual family came from, not just generally as a Jewish person from Eastern Europe. This picture that I'm showing is a picture of my great-great-grandfather, George Rehfield. He's very cute, I'm sure. I never met him. However, this is a person who lived in an area called Posen, which was part of Poland, which was then part of Belarusia, which was then part of Germany. And as you can see, it's very confusing to try to find out what exactly what was happening at the time that he lived there. What I do know from records that my grandfather, his great-grandson, investigated, is that in 1871, I'll just leave this one up here, members of my family came to the United States. And through looking at these maps and with research into what was happening in the Pale of Settlement, just learning about the atmosphere and what it might have been like for members of my family living there as Jewish people, it makes sense to me why they would have come here, and especially at that particular time in 1871. There was a revolution in the part of the country where he was living in the 1840s. That's right when he was born. It was a very interesting thing to be a Jew in Posen. There is a lot of research, actually, that's been done about the Jews of Posen because they were understood to be one of the most concentrated areas of Jewish people living in that area of what was then Poland, but also the most nationalistic about wanting to fit in and be accepted. When Poland was annexed and became part of Germany in the early 1800s, there was a lot of national identity crisis, and people tried to prove themselves as German nationals or Polish nationals. And all of this led to an environment that was very anti-Semitic. And this wasn't just anti-Semitism that was for being Jewish, it was also for being German Jewish or Polish Jewish. So just in investigating this type of map and learning about the land changes and the boundary changes, it really became clear to me, this is not something that is solely a Jewish story. This is actually very related to so many people who have become refugees and come to the United States. So again, so many parallels that people can relate to, whether you have Jewish heritage or not. And in thinking about those parallels, I also realized and understood that I myself, as I'm looking at my family, don't know how many queer people there were in my family prior to me. I do know on one other side there's a queer person, great aunt on another side. But just thinking about these parallels in experience led me to think about the ways in which being Jewish and queer, those experiences parallel each other. So keeping in mind what I just said about refugees and escaping oppression, and if you don't identify as queer, some of these words might be actually new to you. But the thing is that these types of terms that I'm going to share with you are also part of immigrant experience. So ways in which Jewish and queer experiences parallel each other include code switching. Are you familiar? Code switching? Okay. Awesome. What a good audience. I'm very glad. Code switching does happen. It initially was a linguistic term that referred to the switches that occur when you go between one language to another. When you're speaking, if you're bilingual, especially in immigrant communities, if you're able to code switch, this eventually became applied to social sciences as well, and includes the ways that people dress, the ways that people speak in certain communities and then outside of certain communities. And that's just the same within the queer community. So code switching for people who are queer, and this is very general again, but code switching can involve saying things that are known to other queer people, but would not out you to people who are not queer. And then when I was thinking about this history of these countries and borders and boundaries, and realizing during the pandemic, I began to study Yiddish as a hobby, but realizing that Yiddish, in fact, is one of those ways that we can track the movement of people all across the globe, right? And Yiddish-speaking communities are almost like the ultimate form of code switching. There's so much interior knowledge to speaking Yiddish that has to do with Jewish experience, and that has to do specifically with persecution as well. There are codes, literal codes, within Yiddish, and we know this within Hebrew as well. The acronyms that happen, the numerology, all types of codes, just so that you can be understood within a certain community and not be understood exterior to that community. Another way in which Jewish and queer experience parallel each other, the erasure of history, the erasure of your history, the erasure of experience, the erasure of narrative, and the erasure of perspective due to no inclusion. So remember, I did warn you, this could get a little bit dark. But if we think about the way that we learn about ourselves, and then the way that others learn about each other, there is a lot of narrative that is centric to one group, one dominant group, and often queer and Jewish histories are not the dominant narrative. So what I was imagining with these paintings is, what if that is the dominant narrative? What if we were to center queer history as the main history that we are learning from? What if we centered Jewish history? What a different world we could potentially see. One other way in which Jewish and queer experiences parallel each other, the policing of bodies. My painting to my right, your left, includes the back of a body. This is a queer body. This queer body also includes words inside of it that translate to land in Yiddish. I might step away from the microphone just for a moment to point out where that word is. Land. The word in Yiddish, it's written in a Yiddish script. That's how people would write in handwriting rather than the printed version, which uses the aleph base. This is the aleph base, but it's written as a script, like handwriting. This body is central to the image because it is queer. And I, again, am attempting to centralize or center queer experience. And I've also done that with the color choices. Are you all familiar with Miller Paint in Portland? Right? Local. They donated this color of paint to me. Yes, I reached out to them and I said, hey, I'm doing this crazy big painting project. They're very kind. They donate to several local projects every year. But this color combination, these two colors, you can see the kind of lilac. That's one of their colors of the year. It's the color of the year. It's titled Desiree, which in French means desired, desirable. There's also a yellow color there that's, it doesn't have as great of a name, I don't think. But these were two of their new colors for this year. And I was able to reach out to them, as I said, get this donation, and it was just perfect because these were exactly the colors that I wished to have in these paintings. And one of them is, it's color coding for queer people. There's a very high association with lavender, pink, and such with effeminate people across many cultures. And for this particular painting, I am actually drawing from the reference of a queer body. There it is. My reference for this painting, this is a composite, a digital composite that I made using the references that I've mentioned, the map of the Pale of Settlement, a photo of my fiance. She was very kind to let me use this image, and she has given me full rights to mention her personage and that she's in this painting. And the central part of this, I guess, that I'm trying to share is that when we think of our bodies as divine and the land as divine, maybe there isn't room for all of the boundaries and the borders. But there's also this reality that there is history, and there are histories of place where people have come from. And within those places, there are histories of oppression, there are histories of phobias, and there are histories of not being free. So this painting, I focused a lot on, I'll move over to this one in a second, but this is my attempt at liberating the queer body and also incorporating history that is little known, or at least not focused on. So hopefully there is something that you can get out of this, learning about place names, learning some Yiddish, but also learning about how the body is situated in history, especially for queer people. Yes?
Silly question. Is that your handwriting?
Josh had a question. That is my handwriting. Yep, and thank you. So. Yes, I had been studying, and I've done made a great effort to learn how to write in Yiddish. I'm not very good at it still. I can do letter by letter. This is, in the composite, there is a little bit of messaging that didn't get into that painting because I didn't, it just didn't feel appropriate after I went from my reference to the painting, but I was playing with words, and I'll get back on track in a sec, but this idea of the word land in Yiddish.
It is lamed aleph. No,
dalet. That's the dalet.
In script.
Right.
So, the thing that is really interesting to me in finding out about this word land in Yiddish is that, and this is why I use this word, there are actually two words that mean land, but this word means the land as in the nation. And it's a false cognate because in English, you know, we hear land and we just think the earth. The word in Yiddish for earth is erd, but with playing with the idea about nationalism and nations and boundaries and borders, I did want to bring in that idea of land as a land that is a concept. We have a concept of our country, and for people who are bilingual because they've immigrated from other countries to a country, there are all of these concepts, I think, constantly being made part of their identities, the lands that you come from. There's also the English definition to land. So in this composite, I had started out with, where do I land? Just as a way to spur my own thoughts while I was working on the other painting. But the use of language in my work, and I should mention this, is very important because to me, letters are pictures. And when you learn Hebrew, when you learn the Aleph Beis, when you're learning Yiddish, Aleph Beis, it's so apparent that every character, every letter is a picture also. I mean, it's not apparent, like, if you just look at it and you're like, I don't know what this means. but it is part of our visual language. And as Jewish people, the language is actually quite central, as we're, you know, many people are aware of. Language gives passage to civilization across time. So the incorporation of the language and then also the maps and the names is an attempt to bring all of that civilization into the paintings and the history. All right, so I did want to share with you some of the other paintings' meanings and references in this other painting. So I'm going to switch over to this side. So one thing that you can see in this painting is that there's the repetition of the colors, the color palette. So the land and the color, the Desiree and the yellow, are actually both colors of land that I decided to use because they represent land at sunset or land in the dawn. So the body in this painting mirrors the land in this painting and vice versa with the color choice. The complexities in this painting are that there is a map similar to the background of the other painting. The map in this painting represents the Bialystok partisans and the different forested areas into which partisan groups during World War II who were fighting fascists, and not just fighting fascists, but escaping fascists, fled into the forests. This is another way in which land is important in Jewish history. It's not that, not just that we are looking for a land to which we belong, or the land from which we came, but it's also that the land has been a refuge. The map in this piece is the central figure. There are some names of different forests that were well known as partisan strongholds. If you're not familiar with what partisan means, or if you've never read about or heard about the partisan fighting against Soviet and Nazi forces, then I would really encourage you to know that the forests of Europe are a place that hold a lot of memories for many immigrants to the United States for those reasons. There's also another composite image here. This border of the partisan map on the bottom. Is also the horizon line from an image of the Israeli desert, the Negev, which I've never been to. So I don't want to claim any kind of authority about the meaning of this for people when they do go to Israel. But I think it's pretty clear that the desert and the forest both hold immense meaning for people with Jewish heritage. Not only people with Jewish heritage, but when we think about the roles that the desert has played in Judaism, right? It's pretty immense. But then also the forest, literally housing people's bodies and protecting them, is part of what is going on at the top of this painting with the names of some of those forested areas. And I also replicated one of the compasses from one of the older maps that I was looking at. Okay, well, my computer decided it doesn't want me to use it, but... this compass is just one of the features that you can see on a lot of older maps. And so I did incorporate that to tie it in with this other older map that I was using. One moment, I'm just gonna get my slides back up here. So back to queer artists and how this aligns with the experience of Jewish people and Jewish history. I was asked within our collab group about an assertion that I made that when partisans were hiding in the forests, and this was hundreds of people, and it was thousands of people actually, but I made an assertion that there must have been queer people in those groups. And somebody did ask me, well, how do you know that? And the answer that I would give is because there are always queer people. There's literally nowhere that there are not queer people. It's just that we're not educated about it. We're not taught that way. And, that's one of the things that I'm really efforting for with this talk, is to bring the point that whatever you do and whatever you're considering and wherever you go and all the experiences that you have, that you start to think about centering queer perspective. Just as much as we need to also center Indigenous perspective and perspective of immigrant peoples from all over the world, untold or undertold histories need to be centered, and we really need to be changing our perspective about how we consider ourselves and our place in the world through that lens of centering queer perspective. I wanted to share, lastly, a couple of the queer artists that I've been considering while making these works, because I definitely don't make work in a vacuum. If anybody ever tells you that, you know, they didn't have any references for their work, Eric's laughing, because like as a musician, you have hundreds of influences and everything that you see and read, but so there's so many people that I could share with you that are influences, but there are very specific artists that I was considering while I was making this work. Two of them are visual artists, one of whom you actually did see a picture of on the backdrop of the monitor there, but her name is Laura Aguilar. Fortunately, she is did pass away in 2018. this is a not best version of this photo, but luckily it's very good. Well, I shared them with the group in our slideshow, yeah. This is a self-portrait by Lara Aguilar. She was a Chicana Latinx photographer who documented the lives of lesbian Chicana people in Los Angeles primarily during the 90s. She brought this type of identity work to the forefront as a photographer. Her work is very influential for me because it's self-reflective. As we can see in this painting, and she also uses her body as a sculpture, as a subject. I warned you about the nudity, so hopefully no one is surprised. But the nude queer body as a subject is, I think, one of the least celebrated subjects in art history, certainly. So at the time that Lara was making these works, she was really doing something very unheard of, and particularly exploring her dual identities with dual national identities. This piece, Three Eagles Flying, gives you a window into the internal experience of this queer Latina Chicana artist as she struggles to identify with either of the national identities that she's assigned and also born into. She was born in America, and the use of the flag definitely is something that typically isn't outside of an art setting really appreciated, but she's so bold as to incorporate the flag onto her body here, which really visually gives you that feeling of this is how important identity is to people, national identity in particular. Or is it just projected onto you? So again, with my national maps painting, with the body, that's something that I was exploring. And unfortunately, she did pass away, as I mentioned, but some of her portraits of Chicana lesbians are just timeless, and they really capture, again, the idea of code switching and how with identity, with masculine, feminine, we do code switch all of the time, and how much that is really forbidden territory for many people. But I love these portraits that she did in the 90s. And then one last one I'll share with you is another self-portrait exploring the power in just showing your body. And for queer, trans, non-binary people especially, the body is such a battleground. The body is policed constantly. And you have to ask yourself, where are you? In what part do you take in that? And if we look at it from a Jewish perspective and how much Jewish bodies have been policed, what can you find as a parallel for how we also, you know, do that to other people? On that note, River Lynn is an amazing performance artist. He's based in Paris currently, but was born in Taiwan. And this was a project that I was really seriously studying in looking at queer identity as subject. So briefly, River Lynn convened a performance series with dozens of other people participating, in which they occupy a museum and they are simply queer. And you might ask, how does that happen? Well, there's a lot of sex that happens. It's public performance. But they use the queer body performance to make the point that queer history, and again, remember, as a subject of erasure, queer history literally lives in the body of the queer person. A queer person's body is queer history, as long as that queer person is alive. So the use of exhibitionism, literally to make your body into a museum site, was the point of Riverland's My Body is a Queer History Museum project. So I did consider this, I really looked at this a lot while I was making these works. And the last two artists that I wanted to leave you with that are influential for me, but also that you may never have heard of. There's a poet and a performance spoken word poet performance artist, Andrea Gibson. They identify as non-binary, and they use they, them pronouns. And their statement that I found very powerful in explaining the process of painting and what it is to make a painting, or as a visual artist, what are you doing? When I was looking at all of this historical information and putting all of these pieces together to make these images, it was really about exploring myself also, exploring my family's history, exploring how we fit in as people with queer identities into that history. And it's Andrea Gibson writes of their process as a poet, I don't know who I am and write it down. I write and then I know who I am. Just speaking to the process of expression, and the process, especially if you have like a research-based process, there's so much information that you learn, but then when you put it together into a painting, it just becomes something else. It has its own logic and its own locus. And looking at this painting again, on my left, and keeping in mind my ask that we make central queer perspective. This is a poem that's well known by a well-known poet. She sadly passed away in 2019. Her name is Mary Oliver. Many people are familiar with her and her work, but it wasn't until recently, like literally the year that she passed away, that people started talking about her queerness and all of the queer content in her poems. There was a lot about nature that people loved, and that does also relate, you know, how we talk about land in her poems, and a lot about returning to land as a space of reflection and self-knowledge. But there wasn't very much mention of her queerness and the fact that she was a lesbian and she had a lesbian partner and they lived together for 50 years. It's almost impossible to ignore unless you just want to. And the establishment really did not acknowledge that until her death, after which many people with a queer focus started putting together documentation about her life and how much queerness informed her work. And with talking about the desert and how that relates to Jewish identity and heritage and history, I'd love to read this to you and ask if you can project in yourself queerness. Read this with a queer lens rather than just nature. She's just talking about nature. I don't think that that's the case. If you think about the way that queer people have been demonized and homophobia, think about how she's responding to that with this poem. And then also, you know, Jewish history with desert and walking for 4 years, or however many years that was. You do not have to be good. You do not have to walk on your knees for 100 miles through the desert repenting. You only have to let the soft animal of your body love what it loves. Tell me about despair, yours, and I will tell you mine. Meanwhile, the world goes on. Meanwhile, the sun and the clear pebbles of the rain are moving across the landscapes, over the prairies and the deep trees, the mountains and the rivers. Meanwhile, the wild geese high in the clean blue air are heading home again. Whoever you are, no matter how lonely, the world offers itself to your imagination, calls to you like the wild geese, harsh and exciting, over and over, announcing your place in the family of things. So again, if you keep in mind a queer perspective of that, isolation, alienation, being told you don't belong, being told you can't love, that it's not allowed. All of those things do have to do with walking through the desert. Not finding any rain, although we have a lot right now, which is so great. And how does that relate to our history as Jewish people? You know, isolation, alienation, being told you don't belong. So the two paintings that I've made are really ruminations on these parallels between queer and Jewish perspectives and histories and how they are really very related. And I just hope that through exposure to these works, you may have more exposure to history, historical facts, and then also remember to fill that out with queer perspective as you think back on history. And that is what I have to share with you.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming. Thank you, Jessica. Thank you, Art Lab. Again, bring this exhibit is up for, I think, one or two more days, and one of those days of bat mitzvah is happening. So come on tomorrow and experience it now. Really want to thank you again for your presentation and for your art. We're going to miss it. We're going to keep happy hour going for another 10 or 15 minutes. Have a nosh. Have a drink. We do this every once in a while. Check the calendar. Maybe, you know, one day we'll have someone presenting art. Maybe we'll have some live music. Who knows? But thank you all for coming. And once again, Jessica, thank you.
If anyone had any questions, is that okay, Eric?
Yeah, if we could do it, if they could just come up to you individually instead of people been seeing for a long time.
Yeah, so no, you're very free to not ask any questions.
Can they just come up to you like just nonchalantly? And, yeah, okay, great.
Yeah, unless you would like to continue sitting, if anybody wants to.
Well, people
will
just come up and ask you.
Yeah, that one's good.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you for the attention.
But you know what? Next week you'll be able to walk yourself to the store and grab yourself a chocolate. I don't know. Yeah, they are. They are now.
Not too far. I've gone much further before. You what? No.
But not for the art. We're freshly here, though.
So, just visiting or moving on?
I don't know.
to move, I think, but just the summer.
That rain in the middle of the talk didn't go. That's funny, I've been thinking all day about what the heck am I doing here? Portland is not. It doesn't feel very
well, it's not in lots of ways. You know, you have to seek it out, you know?
Right, which is kind of what I'm doing here.
Are you part of a show?
I'm not a member of a show, and I just retired at the beginning of the pandemic, and so I'm kind of in that period of time where I finally have energy and time and to focus on other things besides work.
Excellent. Congratulations.
No, but are you a member of the...
I'm a member of Shirtikva.
Shirtikva.
But I also am a fan of Palmera. So those are both two places that I
just
mirror where I'm at in the world, but
And you know, where I'm from, that happens.
No, you are very
super.
Okay, I can go run through the street. Yeah.
Oh, thank you so much.
Out of one area into another area, Russia. there were so many people coming from different countries trying to escape, not just Jewish people, but like Chinese communities. There were so many people trying to leave conditions in which they were oppressed that there were laws enacted that limited immigration multiple times in the early 19th and 20th century. So much so that when the first wave of people leaving the Pale of Silence happened in the 1880s to come to the United States, essentially, and other places in America, mostly the United States, that was such a huge influx of people that this law was instated that then stayed in place through World War II. And that's why people weren't allowed to come here during. It happened 40 years before. So, yeah. I do want people to have more awareness of that history. Because then the discrimination and things that have led to or how we've been treated as Jewish people in the United States are and what happened before that, right? And it's so sad that I can keep happening over and over again and forgetting conditions. And I definitely, like at Rebecca's project of learning about her family that was granted land that was stolen with them, basically. I don't know if you read about her, but she's written a book. Yeah, she's an author, she's written a book about her family. Inherited land that gave them their start coming from the place that they immigrated from. It's very important to remember the cost at which that land comes. But there's also that the treatment of people who lived here before the colonization was long established before people were immigrating as Jewish people. Like long, long, long mistreatment, total, territory stealing, and that's because there was a very, it's so ridiculous, but it's so related. It was a very anti-Semitic Christian view of the world that said, we are the people that are divinely granted the ability to look for this homeland. It's almost like appropriating Judaism in a way. Oh no, yeah, well, right.
I don't know why. And it's around this ocean. Well, she's scared. Why
are the that's not like cute, but that this document like that I found about this
Thank you.
Oh, wonderful.
All done. Thank you for coming.